Good afternoon and welcome to the First Presbyterian Church of San Luis Obispo. My name is John DeLea. I'm the pastor here. And today we invite you to join us in a brief meditation reflecting on Christ's sacrifice as we remember Good Friday. Good Friday means we're coming to the end of the season of Lent, this time of reflection and repentance as we prepare our hearts for the joy of Easter. And so we invite you to take these few moments to listen to some beautiful music and to hear God's word read and proclaimed and to offer your own life in prayer. Lent is a season where we are meant to look inward for where we need Christ, where Christ has been working in us all along, and where we long to have Christ's presence in the day-to-day lives that we live. And so I invite you to share in this time of worship together. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before you, mindful of the sacrifice that you made on our behalf. Give us hearts that understand, give us lives that reflect, and give us minds that can reflect on what you have done for us and for the world. We pray this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. We begin by hearing some beautiful music together. This year, for Good Friday, we're going to read the story as Mark records it in his gospel. For those of you who haven't read Mark before, Mark is it's different from the other three in that it moves so quickly and the pacing is so rapid right up until it gets to the end of the story, where Mark starts to pay attention to so much detail about these last few days of Jesus' life. I invite you to hear these words. Listen for God's word to you as I read from Mark chapter 15, verses 1 to 15. Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teacher of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. And so they bound Jesus and they led him away and handed him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "You have said so," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. And so again, Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of?" But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now it was the custom at the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate, knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. God's word for us today. The Good Friday story is such a hard story for us. We see Jesus right there in the city of David, right there in Jerusalem, so close to achieving what all of his followers would have thought was his mission in life. And yet, when given the choice of whether to release him to continue his ministry or to choose some common thief and insurrectionist over them, they chose the insurrectionist. They chose Barabbas over Jesus. It's a tough story for us. But like most biblical stories, the story of the people in the Bible is really partly our story. And so it's important for us, as we reflect on this day and reflect on Christ's sacrifice, to think about what's happening in this text. There are three things we ought to notice in this story. The first is that strange business about Jesus not defending himself. You know, he came and he led his ministry for about 3 years before coming to Jerusalem and almost immediately being arrested. Jesus doesn't take this moment with Rome watching, with Jerusalem watching, with the people who had been following him for all that time watching. He doesn't take this time to defend himself, to give an explanation for the ministry that he's undertaken. The second thing is that when given the choice, the people chose Barabbas over him. They chose someone who had disrupted their kingdom and disrupted their order over the Jesus who came to save them. And in the end, notice that Pilate makes his final decision in an attempt to satisfy the crowd. If there's ever a phrase in a text that has meaning both then and now, it's this business about wanting to please the crowd, wanting to satisfy the crowd. So what does that mean for us? What should we take away from this as we come to the end of Holy Week? Just looking briefly at those three things. Jesus didn't defend himself. Jesus could be silent because his life spoke for him. Now, I don't know if that's the case for me or for you, but it's something that we're called to grow into as disciples of Jesus. In the meantime, I think we should keep speaking up, but as much as possible in this life of serving Christ's kingdom and serving and worshiping Christ himself. Certainly our lives should speak for us. And the second thing is, noticing what the people in Jerusalem did on that day, it's important to guard our hearts and minds so that we don't choose someone other than Jesus to be our guide and our model and our Savior. They so willingly were stirred up by the chief priests of the day. They were so easily diverted from their worship and following of Jesus to choose Barabbas over him and to send Jesus to his death. And in the end, it's good for us to remember that our lives aren't about satisfying any crowds, that our lives are meant to be pleasing to God. More than any other day in the church year, Good Friday reminds us of Christ's sacrifice for all of us, for the whole world, even for creation. It reminds us of the lengths that God went to demonstrate his sacrificial love for us. Make that your focus today. Make that your focus this weekend as we live again through these dark days of Jesus dead and buried in a tomb. Make that your focus. Who are you going to satisfy? I invite you, alongside other broken, fallen, flawed believers to your left and to your right and all over the place, I invite you to make serving and satisfying Christ your focus and no one else. Let's hear some more beautiful music, and then we'll close in prayer. As we close our time together today, let's spend a few more moments in prayer. God, we come to you as citizens in a troubled nation and in a troubled world. The pandemic continues to hinder and disrupt our lives, although we can see hope on the horizon. Violence is around us, and in the news, we see all kinds of cruelties being perpetrated by one part of your creation against another. God, as we come to you this weekend, as we focus our attention on your sacrifice and your redeeming work in the world and in each of our lives. May we be open to the ways that you and your Holy Spirit would work inside each of us to make us into the disciples you call us to be. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, betrayed on this day, and the words that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so hear this benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, each and every day. Amen. Go in peace.